Now we will discuss about two-factor authentication, because single factor authentication, namely password, we have enough feel that it is not fully secure. The most common alternatives to just traditional password is to have this hardware tokens or biometric or smart cards. The hardware tokens are very interesting, especially the key. The hardware token generates a random key, and the key that is shown on the token is synced with the key that is generated on the server. And so along with a password, you also enter the value of this key, and the server also will compare this key with the entered key, and since these keys are synced up, the login can happen. If the keys are not synced up, that if you don't have access to the key and you put a random key, then the keys will not match, and essentially the system will not allow the user to log in. So this token, the hardware token, is a very interesting stuff as a second factor, two factor authentication. So why people have not rushed to having this hardware crypto tokens? That we know that conventional passwords are problematic, why this security measure is not even seen in many organizations? One of the thing is, of course, that it is very expensive. Today we are talking of cryptographic token which will go up to 1800 per year per person, and this is a non-trivial expense. Like look at some an organization with 3000 employees or 5000 employees, and to spend some 1000 rupees for each would be, just for an authentication, would be an extremely costly affair, and this is going to be a recurring expenditure also. Now for some websites, for example, PayPal has a security key which is costing around 400 rupees. Now what is that security key? There are two types of security key. There is a normal security key, again there is a mobile phone security key, and if you use the normal security key, it actually gives the same functionality that I described of a hardware crypto key, and this can be used at 400 rupees and for all transactions with PayPal, so that nobody so your login into PayPal is actually authorized much beyond a password, with more security than a password. There are other vendors who compete on price. So this itself, so if you look at this statement, I marked it in red, you say this is industry's first $5 price tag. So as you see here, the price tag becomes extremely important, and that's just because of this price, people did not rush to using hardware crypto tokens in lieu of in addition to passwords. So one of the suggested ways is to have an incremental deployment of this hardware security tokens. First give it to security sensitive people, then totally moved on to administration people, and slowly percolate to other employees. So by limiting the number of tokens you initially want, you can go and slowly keep incrementally deploying these hardware tokens and incrementally giving the tokens to the employees, so that you don't have a single one time cost, but you have a cost which is incremental. So this is one suggested mechanism. This was another example at Purdue. This is the boiler key, which is similar to the hardware token key, but this was used for anyone to get access into the Purdue network. The alternate channel could also be a phone based it's a tokenless phone based stuff, which could be used as a second factor. So So, but this essentially assumes that everyone has a mobile phone, and a magic number is sent whenever you want to log in. A magic number is sent, or a passcode is sent to your, or a one-time passcode is sent to your mobile number, and then that passcode need to be entered. So, if you lose your cell phone, then the person who gets the cell phone can basically get the password, can basically get access, because he can try to log in, but he should know your password, and if he knows your password, then this second factor authentication is of no use because he has access to your cell phone. But this certainly, if everyone has a mobile phone, a personal mobile phone, then it is, the company need not invest on this hardware token, so that it becomes a very, very cost effective scheme. So, to conclude, what we have done so far in module 1, we started looking at again CIA, the confidentiality, integrity and availability, and we now started looking at controls which will ensure confidentiality, integrity and availability. We saw administrative controls, we saw logical controls or technical controls, and inside technical control, we have currently seen access control. The access control again was of two types: the physical access control, which was more of administrative, and the technical. Then we started looking at access control for identification and authentication, and there we looked at passwords. We found that passwords are not very much secure, and we looked at two level authentication, and we also looked at some of the recommendations of standards. What we will do next is on application level security. Applications are those that are part of your process in terms of interpreting and manipulating data, and now how do we get control over the application. So we now talked about how do we get control over the people. Now we will now talk about how do we get control over the process, and finally we will also see how do we get control over the technology. Thank you.